and also some of the ancient grains that you mentioned. There's quite a few ancient grains out there, and I do store some of those ancient grains. They're a lot more difficult to get because they're not as economical to grow. Italy, they're growing quite a few of them. And these are the wheats of the Bible. These are things that the Roman soldiers used for fuel, you know, thousands of years ago.
New studies show that by the time people reach their middle ages, the body often produces less than half of the collagen it did in their youth. Collagen is the main building block in our skin, making up 70 to 80% of it. This is why we get sagging skin and wrinkles as we age. If you want to look younger, you must supplement collagen, which will improve your skin's elasticity, make it smoother, more plump, and more youthful looking. That's why Ageless Multicollagen provides five key types of collagen you need from four different sources, essential to optimally support an array of full body benefits. No odor, no taste, no clumping, unlike other collagen supplements.
And this is why I recommend Health with Adapt 2030. Ageless Multicollagen, and look at that, I need another bag already. Quick way for youthful appearance. Use the link in the description box below for 51% off my favorite Ageless Multicollagen. And now on with the video.
And good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. Special guest, Kevin Snow. David, a lot of the things I talk about, crop losses here, economic reductions over there, but today it's going to be more about what we can do about it. So we're going to talk about harvest eating, and Chef Keith Snow has the Harvest Eating YouTube channel. Also, if you go back and look at some of the prior videos there, had the television series of Harvest Eating, and then also right over on harvesteating.com. Today's talk is going to be all about how to store foods for a longer amount of time, because right now things are bountiful in the harvest. If you go to farmers co-ops, you're going to find every bin's full. Bulk buying, you know, I buy from the Amish down the road over here, and they had 5 ears of corn for $15, sweet corn. They had, you know, 15 pounds of green beans for $15, but that's in a bulk. So wherever you go right now is the best time to buy foods. And then think about the seasonality of the foods. It's going to switch over to fruits later on. From the present fruits that we have with apricots and different types of summer berries, which we need to store those up. But then we're going to switch over to the apples, the pumpkins, and you can get that full year round. So probably, I'm going to say 6 months of the year, you don't have access to, you know, very fresh foods. So you're going to have to store that. And I am trying to learn the best I can here. I'm happy Keith is joining me because I am here to learn. And I'm really hoping that today's talk is going to give you some very solid information that you can share with your friends, your families, help you save money, help you have a healthier, you know, diet moving through. I know canned foods have a lot of sodium, and I, you know, I store food as well, but I like to mix fresh in when I have a chance. And this is what it's all about today. Storing the foods, being able to take what you have in different ways, fashions, and forms. We want to be able to store our own, grow our own, trade our own with others. So Keith, welcome. Floor is yours.
Yeah, no, it's a good point. I'm a big fan of the Austrian School of Economics. And there's a gentleman that I've followed for years. His name is Jim Rogers. He's an older dude.
I know Jim.
Yeah, and he's famous for telling people, you need to become a farmer. So your point about it being a lifestyle, I mean, living healthfully and becoming more in touch with your food supply, it's not something you do, you know, Saturday morning. And this is something that you need to kind of become engrossed in. And people, like you mentioned, musicians, they don't become excellent musicians because they play 3 or 4 hours a month. I mean, they dedicate themselves to it. When you're talking about growing food and increasing food security and building, you know, a homestead and just more security in general, you need to be reading about it, buying books about it. I mean, when I drove here to do this interview with you, I was listening to a podcast called Epic Gardening, and it's short, very well produced. And lately they've been talking a lot about perennial crops. I mean, So each day I'm trying to learn more and more, like I mentioned with regenerative agriculture. I've never done it on a large scale. Hopefully I will one day, but these are things that you can learn about. And every day I learn something else about food, whether it's how to, you know, well, I've been making bacon a long time, but how to make your own bacon, or how to make, you know, medicine from plants, how to sharpen a tool that you need, how to, you know, change the oil in your tractor. Any of these things, they take time and practice. And I think we need to put a little more attention on becoming farmers and learning to take part in our food supply. Really important.
You know, with that being said, so we're talking about food, a little bit of food storage. Again, you know, you mentioned easiest things to grow. Now walk me through, give me a couple ways of, okay, I'm a total beginner. I'm going to go to the store today. I'm going to purchase something. You can still get canning jars, because almost everywhere we went to today, from the supermarket to the farm co-ops, just down to the hardware store, everybody's got jars. Not large. They're all real small. The biggest ones we saw were like quart jars, but I like those half gallon size, or even a full gallon, where you can put a lot of mass into it. Okay. So the jars behind me, great. That's one way to store some stuff. But what are some other real easy ways for people to put something up for a little bit longer to be able to store it? I'm interested to learn this myself.
I'll touch on a few things, but let's just start with grains. So I buy grains to store. Now, whole grains, you know, wheat, even corn, oats, these type of things will store a long time, not as flour, but as whole grains. So find a source of these that are non-GMO and organic. And I buy them in 50-pound sacks. And I store everything in my pantry that would enable me, you know, when you go to the supermarket, you want to bake bread. So maybe you'll get bread flour, whole wheat flour, all-purpose flour. So I mimic those grains in my storage, and I buy them, like I said, from an organic source. And then I put them in Mylar bags. Those are very heavy-duty bags that I buy on the internet in bulk, and enough that it'll fit inside of a five-gallon bucket. Now, five-gallon buckets have become expensive, but you can go to certain stores and bakeries and they throw them out. So one of them is a sub shop that I go to, and they used to just give them to you. Now they sell them to you for $3, but I buy, you know, 10, 15 of these things per month. And then I buy grains and I pour them into Mylar bags. I put oxygen absorbers in them and I seal the bag and store it in a cool or climate controlled. You don't want to put this stuff in an attic or a garage. And, you know, we have probably 450 pounds of grain stored. That's one thing. What about if you can go and make jam? So I mentioned apricots earlier. You can buy some apricots, one of the simplest jams to make. You just simply take the apricots, you remove the pit, you put them in a pot, you add some sugar, some lemon juice, a little bit of pectin, you bring that up to a boil and you cook it for about an hour or so. Use a potato masher and you mash it all up. Make sure it's at a nice hard boil. You put it into your canning jars, put the lid on them, and then you don't even need a pressure canner for that. You just put it in a water bath. So it's like a, you know, a large spaghetti boiling water pot, and you put your jars in there and you process them for 20 or 30 minutes. Look online for something called the Ball, B-A-L-L, Ball Blue Book. It's sort of the Bible of canning, and you can make your own jam. Other things that you can do that are simple are you can make your own yogurt, either with store-bought milk or with local milk. It's very easy to make it. You just take, you know, a gallon of milk and you'll add some yogurt to it, like one cup of yogurt. You have to make sure it's the type that doesn't have corn syrup and flavorings, not the Yoplait, but the stuff that has actual bacteria in it. And you inoculate the milk with that, and then you'll cook it for a period of time, and then it sits. What we used to do is put it into quart jars, and we would do six at a time and put them into an igloo cooler, and we'd fill it halfway up with 190 degree water, cover it, and let it sit for, you know, 18, 20 hours, and you'd come back and you could turn it upside down and it was solidified yogurt. So there's lots of things that you can do. Again, these home economic projects to put up and store food. Flour and things like that don't store very well. I mean, we keep quite a bit of it on hand. What is that? Oh, grain mill. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a hand crank grain mill. So I'm going to be trying a couple different ones. I got barley, wheat, spelt, And I'm going to try to grind through a few of these and see. Oh, I have sorghum and buckwheat as well. So some of these more ancient grains, like amaranth's way too small to consider to use this anyway. But millet, again, a little too small for this. But I'm more into the ancient grains as well. So I'm starting to think about flours and which one will grind better. And how much does it really take to grind down to be able to create a loaf of bread? And how much calorific output will that take? I mean, it's great that we can grind something here. I haven't even unboxed this yet. This is one of the things I want to do is put this on the workbench and grind out a bunch and see how long it'll take to, you know, get 3 cups of flour.
Yeah.
And if I can do different combinations of grind as well between, you know, some barley and some, you know, some hard red winter wheat. I got some soft white. And I got a couple different kinds of wheat like you do. And then just the different hardy grains. Because at the co-ops around here, when you buy a bag, because I have a registered farm, you go in, it's a 50-pound bag. That's kind of the minimum size you would buy. So it's quite easy to scoop out a couple quarts of, you know, grain. But how long will it really take you to hand grind that? Because I've seen a fair few videos. It comes out, but it comes out really slow. And if there's any way I could put a motor onto this thing, can you motorize a hand-powered tool? You know, just some of these things just to experiment with. I'm not really sure. But the more you make the mistake, the better you learn how to do it next time. And eventually you're going to, you know, come up with something that could be usable in something real simple fashion. You know, maybe using a house fan with some sort of belt on this thing to make it spin faster. Who knows? I'm going to experiment with a few things.
Yeah, well, I've been down that road, and because of the television show and the website videos, a lot of manufacturers have reached out through the years and wanted to get their stuff pictured on the television set or in the video. So I've had an opportunity to work with a lot of mills, and I've had 2 or 3 hand crank mills, and yeah, they work, there's no question about it. But the amount of effort it takes is extraordinary to get enough to make some. One of the videos in the Food Storage Feast course, it's a whole wheat Pullman loaf. And it's a loaf pan that anybody can get on Amazon. It's called the USA Pan Company. It's a really great pan. And I use that to make bread in the course. Now, I've done just what you've talked about, is I wanted to see what it would take to grind it by hand. So I was fortunate enough. We lived in Montana for a while, and our neighbor literally was the producer of the grain maker. And it's a big red grain mill. It's hand cranked, but it's manufactured in a way that on the big wheel, you can put a belt on it and either connect it to an electric motor, or you can even do it on a stationary bike. So people will do that, just sit on a stationary bike and pedal their way through a couple of pounds of grain. I also purchased, I've had several electric ones, and some of them are not very high quality, but I have an Austrian made, or German, I think it's German or Austrian made, it's called Komo, K-O-M-O. So I paid $500 for a Komo grain mill, and I spent extra money to get the one in black walnut, because that's my favorite wood. So it's a very pretty mill, but it does a tremendous job. So I will make this loaf of bread. We usually make it once or twice a week. Sometimes if there's a new neighbor or something, or an older person, I make bread to give away. And it's 34 ounces of flour that need to be ground. So we'll put it into this mill, and it literally just takes 3 or 4 minutes to grind it with the electric mill. So it's very, very convenient. And I use different grains, like you mentioned. One of my favorites to put in bread is rye. So rye is excellent. It's also great for making sourdough starter. So we make sourdough breads as well as yeasted breads, but I'll use rye flour and then spring white wheat and hard winter wheat all in one bread and mix it all together. And what I do to make it more healthful, if it's a sourdough, it's going to go you know, at least 24 hours before it's baked. But even when I make a yeasted bread, I'll let it ferment for 24 hours. And that completely changes the texture, the flavor, the nutritional situation inside, because a lot of people struggle with gluten. And you could be using organic or conventional grains, but they still have gluten. So if you have those things fermenting for a long period, the bacteria in the fermentation breaks down some of these proteins that are hard to digest and makes them less of a problem. I mean, there's a lot of studies. I just read a big long article out of Europe the other day where true sourdough bread fermented a minimum of 12 hours is safe for people that are diagnosed with celiac disease to eat. So if somebody that's just sensitive to it, if you're finding breads that are that have long fermentation, those are much better. And these are, again, going back to your comment earlier, they're more nutritionally dense. And these are things that we need to learn at home, because anybody can make, you know, a 3-hour bread, but those quick fermented breads are not nearly as healthy. And also some of the ancient grains that you mentioned, there's quite a few ancient grains out there. And I do store some of those ancient grains. They're a lot more difficult to get because they're not as economical to grow. Italy, they're growing quite a few of them. And these are the wheats of the Bible. These are things that the Roman soldiers used for fuel, you know, thousands of years ago. But they don't grow as dense as modern hybridized wheat. But there's a lot of varieties of those. And you can find them on the internet, and they do taste a lot better. And I store those grains myself. I think they're wonderful. I've also messed around quite a bit with buckwheat, making gluten-free breads with buckwheat. So yeah, there's a lot to learn out there, David, for sure.
I have two different types of millet. I have the Japanese silver millet, and then I have the German millet. The Japanese silver millet, just like a rocket ship out, the birds loved it. The German millet, I don't know, maybe it was the rainfall, maybe it was the temperature, it didn't grow nearly as well. But the buckwheat, it's that for the pollinator habitat for the bees as well. And, you know, if you mow that down, it'll grow right back. So you can get a double crop out of that. I'm not talking about bringing it all the way to grain, but bringing it up to flower, let the flowers fall off where they start to grain head. And then if you cut that, silage for animals, but just trying to bring it up for the flowers for the bees to have, you know, because they come into the dearth in this time of the year when there's really not a lot of, you know, pollen out there, not a lot of nectar flowing. So, you know, bees get incredible hungry. But to be able to have a grain that you could put out there, even if it's a small amount. And then after the second turn right now, I am going to let it come to full head, and then I'll try to harvest that. I don't have anything to harvest it with right now. So I'm just still in the process of how, okay, so we could talk, you know, it's easy to go buy a 50-pound bag of grain from a farm co-op that's nicely dried and wrapped in a paper bag, sewn up, and that's great. But what are you going to do when you come up with 3 tons of grain by yourself in a wagon behind you? Then what? Where do you put it? And this is where you come back to, oh no, you got all these weevils and different kind of pests that are going to get in there. So it would be the same thing with a cabbage. Okay, 2 heads of cabbage, 3 heads of cabbage. That's pretty easy. Okay, 2 tons of cabbage, now what? So when you're thinking about when you're scaling it up, then it comes into a whole different ball game of trying to think how to store and preserve things on a larger scale.
Yeah, I just recently watched a video of a guy that wanted to grow his own wheat. And I think he was in South Carolina. It's a very humid climate, can make it a little more difficult. And he showed the entire process of planting the wheat, letting it grow, harvesting it, threshing it. It takes a lot of effort to do that. And yeah, you're going to work for it. I think it's an important crop to grow. I've never threshed wheat myself, so I know it's a process. And like you said, if you have harvested these things, what do you do with it all? Well, I think you use some of these techniques we talked about: canning, fermenting, processing, drying. But also, we need to work together as a community. And there's going to be people around you that have things that you don't have that may need the things that you have. So giving away bread, giving away cabbages, you know, hey, you've got some peppers, I've got tomatoes. These are the things that we need to do, because if we don't have community, it's going to be difficult to really get through what I think is coming. I think we need to have strong neighborhood connections. And one of the things I've always done, no matter where I've lived, is it seems to always have a lot of elderly people around. I've always brought food and shared food with neighbors and friends. I mean, we lived at one point near some older Southern people, and I would bake bread for them, and they absolutely loved it. And they would show up at the house and give us strawberries. They would give us apples, all different types of things that were grown, you know, on their place, or friends and family, or just sources that they knew. So that's definitely an important thing to keep in mind, is building community. But yeah, it's a learning process for sure. And you mentioned some of those ancient grains. I keep spelt, which is an ancient grain. I keep some einkorn, and I keep kamut. And there's growers up in Montana that grow kamut, or kamut, however you pronounce it. So these ancient grains are unique to cook with. I'll tell a story. When we were filming an episode, there is a gentleman that I think people need to know about. His name is Glenn Roberts, and his company is called Anson, A-N-S-O-N, Anson Mills. He's in Columbia, South Carolina. And we filmed the TV episode with him. And this guy stores all varieties of ancient seeds. And he's a very important person for our food supply. And he's saved so many of the old corns and wheats and oats, you name it, he saves it. And I've been in his warehouse before, and it was a little scary because he was telling me that some of the big GMO seed companies, they don't want this guy in existence. So they're always trying to send him, he keeps several addresses, and they're trying to send him crops to then put out a news story that his sources are contaminated with GMO. So they send him, they send him seeds that are GMO seeds. Oh, would you look at these and test these? And he'll test everything, but he tests it in the laboratory away from his stash of stuff. And he's had that happen multiple times. So when we were in his warehouse, there's no sign on the building. You would never know it's there. It's an old metal building. And when we walked in there, it was creepy, David. There were probably 200 7-8 foot long white chest freezers. And he turned on these lights, and you know, you didn't know what was going to be in these chests, but he would go and lift them up, and they'd be filled with different corns and wheats and all these things from all over the country. And he'll send out seeds for free to farmers to grow them, and he'll send them to multiple areas for diversity. He won't send them to, you know, Kansas, so to speak, where they could get tornadoes. He'll send them to many different states, and whoever can deliver a harvest, that's the real thing. So he knows what seeds he sent. When the harvest comes back, he requests a sample, he tests it in his laboratory, and if it's the real thing, then it can make it into his supply. But one of the things he had was an ancient grain called, it's a whole wheat called red fife. And when I was there, he went into one of the coolers, he scooped it out, and then he's got these very old stone mills, and he's very careful about the way he grinds it to avoid heat, because when you're grinding, it creates a tremendous amount of friction. So he uses stones, and he injects, as it's grinding, liquid nitrogen onto the stones to keep the temperature below 100 degrees. So I had a recipe for whole wheat bread using the best store-bought whole wheat flour I could find. And, you know, it rose. We ate it. It was never great. And then I made the exact same recipe with wheat that he ground for me. I made it the next day. And this thing, David, it was night and day. It was three times the size. And I'm pretty precise. I don't use volumetric. I use very sensitive scales. So I know about baking with my chef background. And the bread that I can make with his freshly ground heirloom grain like that, it wasn't even the same product. And then when I ran out of it, because he gave me 5 pounds and I switched back immediately, the bread went back to that super dense, nasty stuff. So there is a difference in these foods, and there's people out there that are doing some really great work. So, I could talk about this stuff all day, as you might imagine. It's exciting to me, and I'm very interested in the food system and just finding great sources.
Yeah, that kamut, that's one that's, I don't think I've ever run across. And, you know, even finding spelt is like a wow, you know, you like get excited at whoa, look what I found, you know, buried treasure somewhere. And, you know, you talk to, there's so many food allergies that are happening today. So I find myself, this is my own, when I eat a lot of the, shall we say, canned foods that are stored for, you know, you could 3-year can of beans or whatever. When I start to eat a lot of that, I notice that my skin's quite different, that I start to feel just non-digestion in there. Just things are hanging around much longer because I'm putting so much fresh green. I definitely know how my body operates and how long it takes to, you know, before my stomach starts grumbling again, before I get hungry. Yeah, I'm using baking soda with water to try to keep the alkalinity up there. But, you know, once you start eating and nibbling on those foods, a lot of preservatives and chemical factory stuff, you really, really, really feel it different in your body, the way your digestion performs and the way that the skin is as well. But then, you know, you bring that over into the grains and how many people have wheat allergies and corn allergies because it's all GMO, but then, you know, you come into the millets are not really GM'd so much yet. That's why the Japanese silver millet is not a GM variety. But, you know, coming down into an emergency situation where you might not have a choice at that point, you always want to have a choice, because I don't want to be at the behest of somebody feeding me only factory processed GM, and that's all I have to stay alive on. And if you start to get sick, then there's no other choice. Then that's not a choice. So to have something stored up and seeing into the future a little bit, this crystal ball of where we're moving and knowing your own bodies, knowing the people around you closest, what kind of food allergies do they have, what resonates, because you don't want to buy a bunch of stuff that nobody's going to eat or they're not really fond of the taste. You know, if you make a huge pot of something, but nobody, like myself, I'm not a fan of onion soup really. So if you made a gigantic pot of onion soup, I'd be like, all right, I'll eat a little bit, but it's not like I'd devour the entire pot. So you get all these, so many facets to think about when you're trying to prep out and store and, you know, create foods that are healthy and nutritious. But at the same time, you know, there's all these different, there's not just a single balance on a scale. There's multiple scales and different dimensions moving during this thing that you need to think about and which ones store the longest. You know, these pumpkins are great. Pumpkin season's coming up. You know, you put the straw up there and put them on the racks and you can keep those for months, half a year. But what if things go bad really quickly? I mean, you can't keep lettuce that long. So it's just so many things to continuously think about. And, you know, we could fill up 6 notebooks between you and I of these different things that might need to be thought about moving into these changes here.
One of the things when I created this course, Food Storage Feast.
I'm interested in, you know, showing the people watching the interview tonight, where can they go to start being self-sufficient on their own, self-sufficiently, not having to rely on other people, but learning the skills, watching it, doing it, practicing it? Like, where do you find this course you're talking about?
If you visit foodstoragefeast.com, you'll find a link to it. Also, if you visit harvesteating.com and look on the top of the site, there's a link right to the course. I'll provide a coupon code for you to help your viewers get a discount to get into the course. And once they're inside, there's a lot of written information in there that shows and really gives people an idea, because, you know, maybe the entire food system doesn't collapse. Maybe we don't, you know, get hit by a nuclear bomb, but what about a job loss? What about a hurricane? Like friends of mine in Florida a few years ago, I mean, these people I've known for a long time, and I visit their house and you look in the pantry and they have children. There's not 2 days worth of food in there during a perfect scenario. And a couple of years ago, one of the hurricanes went through Florida, and this guy was telling me there was no bread left in the public supermarket. Most of the stuff was empty 2 days before the storm. People were getting in fistfights at the gas station. They were brawling for bottled water at Home Depot. And these things happen. It doesn't necessarily need to be a major event, just a normal event. So I put this course together to help people that they need to be home during those things and helping their neighbors and you know, their friends, and not being in a panic. So all the reasons that you might want to store food. And then it goes into a lot of other things, like you mentioned earlier, you know, an electric or a hand cranked grinder. We talk about how to cook food in an emergency, because there's a lot of easy ways to cook food in an emergency if there is a power outage, different stoves that we tested. Like, I will regularly cook on little butane stoves. Like, I'll go and cook bacon out there. I'll cook a lot of things out there, even during a good time. After we give you a pretty good idea of why you need to store food, then we start to break down the ingredients one by one, the major ingredients. So rice and beans, for instance, oats, wheat, corn. We talk about all these things, about which varieties store better, ways to store them. And then we offer recipes and videos with those foods. Now, you mentioned, you know, not wanting to eat big, nasty things. And this is why I encourage people, and they have been doing it since I put this course up on the internet. You don't want to wait until something bad happens to learn how to make these foods. You want to be regularly doing it. These are good for everyday use. I serve this food to my family on a regular basis. This isn't something that I put off in the corner. This is part of our daily meal. And nowadays, with food inflation, you can stretch your budget out a lot by cooking these dishes. So